Good morning. Good morning. We're going to stand together and we're going to sing God So Loved. If you haven't already told him how much you love him, now's the time.
Come all ye weary, come all ye thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Well, come all ye sinners, come find his mercy, come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of find what you're looking for God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
Does indeed. Let's be seated.
Good morning. It's good to see everyone. A couple of things before I forget. I know I don't always do it. If you see these cards, if you're new here or just visiting, we'd certainly this one's scribbled on by someone, but find one that's not scribbled on, and we'd certainly love to give you some more information about our church. Opportunities here if you're interested in serving, but we'd love to have just a little bit of information. And again, we don't show up on your doorstep. Or, you know, we'll give you a couple of days to settle in, and we'll call you. But we'd love to get some more information about that. Coming up, before I do that, just a couple of things on our prayer request list. Obviously, there's many needs on here, but most recently we had Jared Brown. I know last Sunday we talked about, I think happened kind of real time last Sunday. So I know he's had some burns, and certainly, you know, reach out to Melanie and Johnny if you have things there. But certainly keep praying for him and them and healing and blessing there. And a praise here, David Wood, Sharon's brother. It looks like had negative results there for cancer, and so that's certainly a praise, and others here as well with some recent news. So we lift them up to God and thank Him for those and praise for those. We have the Lord's Supper today, which we will participate in, those that are believers, and we certainly welcome you with open communion. Coming up, business meeting next week, we have a presentation that I think the date had changed, Evan and Tony, right before, was on April 21st. That presentation, The Burial Place of Jesus, will be 6 p.m. I assume it's in here. So that'll come up. And then we have the car show and fish fry, May 11th. I don't know, John, do you want to add some more? Or are you coming up?
Coming up. The only thing is, it's for silent auction items. If anybody wants to donate anything for silent auction or put something together, just get with me. Let me know. Call me on my phone number. It's listed there. You can give me a call, and that way we can get that stuff squared away and what all we're going to have for the silent auction part of it. But yeah, it's looking like it'll be a good turnout, good time. So look forward to seeing everybody.
Okay. And then we do have DBS. Mentioned last week, there's a sign up in the back. That's May 28th through the 31st. Certainly have a space there for you if you're interested in volunteering. I know that there's always a need, and I think they usually have quite a few people through the week that they need, and some come in, some come out, and depending on who's available. So being in the evening, it'll help hopefully with work schedules for those that work during the day. I believe that's it, unless I missed anything. Oh, yes, sorry, I did miss something. Evan told me before, Annie Armstrong, donation that was taken last week, that raised, I believe he said, $2,200. So certainly a great thing there.
As mentioned, that goes 100% to the field.
That's super impactful to those that are serving around North America. So I will pray for us, and we can get started. Heavenly Father, just thank you for the day. Again, this... this certainly those on our prayer request list, we lift up to you those that need healing, and just the needs there. Thank you so much for those that have gotten good positive news lately with cancer results, and that they've been able to maybe have a little less stress in their life. We just ask a healing upon those. Just thank you again for this Annie Armstrong contribution that was made to just serve in missionaries around North America. Just be with our church, be with this community. Just pray for rain when we can get it. We just know it's going to be probably another hot summer, and we just we'll take what rain we can get now. And we just thank you and praise you, and just look forward to the service ahead and as we celebrate and Lord's Supper and what that means to us as Christians, as believers, and the sacrifices that were made for our sins. Things we ask for in Jesus' name. Amen. And I missed one more. I don't have all the details, so I'm not going to. I believe Jared Barthel this morning, I think I heard maybe is having some health issues, and so certainly lift that family up to you. So,
good morning, church. Turn this thing on. There we go. I'll start over. Good morning, church. Good to see y'all here this morning. It is a blessing to be here this morning, opportunity to take part in the Lord's Supper, take part of the bread and the cup as Jesus Christ sacrificed, the ultimate sacrifice for our sins. And it's a privilege we get to, as believers, take a part in that. Scripture reading for this morning is from Revelation 1. I'm going to read verses 1 through 8. Revelation, John. the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show to his servants the things that must take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and who keep what is written in it, for the time is near. So hopefully we'll be blessed by reading this aloud today. Amen. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of kings on earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us a kingdom, priest to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is, who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. May God bless the reading of his word. Let's continue in worship and song.
Unclasp and set me free.
silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me, Spirit divine. Open my mouth and let me bear gladly the warm truth everywhere. Open my heart and let me prepare love with thy children thus to share. Silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my heart, illumine me, Spirit divine. Open, there we go. Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like a fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Amen. You may be seated.
Heavenly Father, just thank you for the day. Just ask that you bless this offering. Just ask that you bless the gifts that are given. It's all yours. We're just giving back a small portion, that this would be used to further your kingdom in Valley View, in this community, in this church. Just thank you for the membership here and just those that give. We just, again, ask a blessing upon this offering that can be used to further your will. Things we ask for in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
supposed to have it all together. And when they ask how you're doing, just smile and tell them never better. Lie number two, everybody's life is perfect except yours. So keep your messes and your wounds and your secrets safe with you behind closed doors. The truth be told, the truth is rarely told. I say I'm fine, yeah I'm fine, oh I'm fine, hey I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken, when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not. And you know it, I don't know why it's so hard to admit it. Being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth be told. There's a sign on the door, says come as you are, but I doubt it. Cause if we lived like that was true, every Sunday morning pew would be crowded. Didn't you say church should look more like a hospital? A safe place for the sick, the sinner and the scarred and the prodigals like me. Truth be told, the truth is rarely told. The only one who says I'm fine, yeah I'm fine, oh I'm fine, hey I'm fine, but I'm broken. When it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not. And you know it. I don't know why it's so hard to admit it. Being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth be told. Can I really stand here unashamed? Say I'm fine, yeah I'm fine, oh I'm fine, hey I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken, when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not. And you know it, I don't know why it's so hard to admit it. Being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. Yeah, I know. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth be told.
Amen. It reminds me, how many of y'all have asked, checked up on somebody, and they usually say the automatic response, I'm fine, I'm doing fine. How many of those times are you actually fine? Jesus knows, God knows every thought, amen? We need to come before Him with the truth. He gives us our joy. He lifts us back up when we're having problems, when we're in distraught. Thank you, Beth. That was wonderful. Have you ever let people around you who are worrying affect your faith? One minute you have a firm grip on a belief, but you hear nothing but words of worry from those around you. Or you're listening to too much wrong news. The news can do that. This can get you to question your belief. I think this was the case for these two disciples that were walking to Emmaus and with Jesus at the time they didn't know it. And so That's where our message will be from today, Luke 24, verses 13 through 43. You know, last week we started with verse 44, and now we're going to go backwards and pick up what happened up to verse 44. So, verse 13 through 43. Verse 13 says, that very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, what is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk? And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days? And he said to them, what things? I found that amusing. And they said to him, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning. And when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. And he said to them, O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets had spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter in his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures of the things concerning himself. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he were going further, but they urged him to strongly saying, stay with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is now far spent. So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures? And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, the Lord has risen indeed, and has appeared to Simon. Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. As they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, peace to you. But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And he said to them, why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, have you anything here to eat? They gave him a piece of broiled fish. And he took it and ate before them. I find this also amusing, verse 41, of him asking for something to eat. Shows us the very human side of Jesus. I can just picture him kind of nonchalantly. Great to see y'all. You got anything to eat? And different responses from the disciples, perhaps. Some of them still like frozen in spot. They can't move. Others, they're jumping to their feet to be the first one to serve Jesus, right? Now, before we get into application of this text, let me just quickly say that this Emmaus that we're talking about is unlikely the spot, the Emmaus that they went to. There's a Emmaus that is, I believe it's 22 miles from Jerusalem. And here it says they traveled 6 stadia, which is 7 miles. So there are several spots that some people say that is the Emmaus. There are several others. In historical texts, there are two other Emmauses, is that right? So one of them is 3.5 miles west of Jerusalem. So if you add that up, 3.5, 3.5, that'd be 7 miles round trip. It's very possible that could be it. Anyway, nonetheless, you know, it says that it was towards evening, right, that they invited Jesus in. And so by this time, it could be dark. If they traveled 22 miles back to Jerusalem, that's possible. I mean, if they're running, I think if I were just told this, I'd probably run. I don't know if I would make 22 miles, but I would attempt it. In any case, if you go to Israel and they take you to a Emmaus site, it is still a very beautiful site to visit. There's a Byzantine church there, ruins of a Byzantine church, 5th, 6th century, some tombs, and a new church that you can have service in. So anyway, all right. Now let's look at the doubt of these disciples. The first hint of doubt is in verse 21. So they've already built up Jesus. All that they know about him. He was the one to come, the one to save Israel. And in verse 21, it uses that word, but we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. But Jesus responds to them, and he says, slow of heart to believe, in verse 25. O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe. And then later that day, as they're back in the upper room, yet again, another doubt arises. Let's see here, verse 38. And he said to them, why are you troubled, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet. It is I, myself. Touch me. See. And in verse 41, after all this, they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling. I mean, they had seen Jesus perform many miracles. These were a couple of his disciples. Just the week before, they had a meal during that Passion Week. They had a meal at Bethany, and Lazarus was there. Lazarus, who Jesus raised from the tomb from the dead. So they had seen this done before. Doubt misleads. It's like having a split personality, right? Your body is trying to go in two different ways at the same time. James tells us in James 1, 7 and 8, but when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all they do. Have you let doubt affect your faith? When we pray, we must not have doubt, but believe that He can do all things if it is according to His will. Just because He hasn't given you that red, you know, that red Ferrari, it doesn't mean He can't do it. It means it's not His will to give you that red Ferrari. God asks us to approach our life decisions and circumstances following one source. He calls us to commit to faith in Him. Continuously choosing to believe in what He says according to Scripture. We become unstable when we mix our human perspectives with God's perspective on our situation. So these disciples, they were focused on an empty tomb and no body of Jesus. They forgot the godly perspective of what Jesus had told them. I will rise on the third day. I will come back. They had lost sight of that. Perhaps they let those around them affect them. Everybody's worrying, where is Jesus now? And they're losing hope because they're losing the godly perspective. We must not let this human perspective and worldly perspectives affect our focus on what God has promised us. If you hear something bother you in the news, read God's word. If you have doubt that He's listening, read God's word. If you have doubt that He will provide, read His word. And you know that you're never alone. He's with us all the time. In fact, He's right here in this room with us right now. The next thing I want to point out is how He opened their eyes to see. Jesus opens our eyes to see. Verse 16. But their eyes were kept from recognizing Him. This is as they're walking to Emmaus. God, I believe this is God that kept them from recognizing Jesus. It's a lack of recognition that allowed Jesus to teach the necessity of His death and resurrection and to show how this was the fulfillment of Scripture, verse 26 and 27. Although this time it was God that purposely did something so they wouldn't recognize Him. I don't know, it doesn't tell us. Somehow God made it happen. Can't explain those things. I can't help but think of the many times that we are blinded by the world, by Satan, from seeing Jesus. Darkness blinds us from seeing God's works. Darkness blinds politicians and leaders from getting direction, godly direction, to make God-led decisions for our state, for our country. I mean, you could turn on the TV and automatically get sucked in, right? So all the commercials, advertisements, your spouse could be hollering in the other room, I need some help in here. And you're like, yeah, I'll be there in just a minute. Your eyes glued to the TV. God Himself could call your name out and you wouldn't hear it. You're distracted. You've been blinded. When our eyes are not fixed on Jesus, when we've been lacking in prayer, been lacking in reading in His Word, we're more likely going to be blinded by Satan. How many of you have seen the read or seen Case of Christ, Case for Christ? By Lee Strobel? Yeah. In this movie, there's a man who he's been wrongly accused of shooting. And before he's let out of prison, he gets beat up really bad in prison. And he has to be hospitalized. And Lee Strobel, who is then a writer, journalist for the Chicago Tribune, he goes to visit him and wants to apologize to this man because he did a write-up accusing him, wrongly accusing him of this shooting. And so Lee apologizes and he says, I'm sorry, I didn't see it. The wrongly accused inmate says to Lee, you didn't want to see it. You didn't want to see it. He already made up in his mind what he was going to report. Think of times we have already made up in our minds before seeing it. Think of how we have already believed what we want to believe, or we hear what we want to hear, with our preconceived ideas. You know, some try to force an interpretation on God's word with, you know, a preconceived idea to fit our wants instead of what God is really saying in that passage. We listen to what we want to hear instead of what we need to hear sometimes. Sometimes we listen to the lies of Satan instead of the truth of God. Or like these two disciples, they've already been told by Jesus what he was going to do, right? Perhaps they witnessed the crucifixion, but their doubts kept them from seeing the truth. When we fix our eyes on the cross, the light, on the truth, on his word, our eyes will be opened. We'll be able to make the right decision because we're closer to having the mind of Christ. We've been in his word, we've been praying with him, and we're more likely to have the mind of Christ. We've set ourselves up then to have a greater opportunity of being blessed and then sharing the word with others. Now I want to look at the breaking of the bread of this text. In verse 28, I'm going to read this again. Verse 28, so they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he were going further. Again, I find that funny. They're like, here, come on in, Jesus. Oh, okay, well, if you insist. He already knows he's have a divine encounter with him. This has already been planned. But they urged him strongly, saying, stay with us, although it is toward evening, and the day is now far spent. So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. Now, watch this in verse 31. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. Notice it's at this point of the breaking, the blessing of the bread, that their eyes were opened. You know, Luke could have said that they recognized him by his pierced hands, right? He grabs the bread, he breaks it. Surely they recognize his pierced hands. That wasn't it yet. Surely they would have recognized his voice as they're walking with him. But somehow they didn't recognize that either. God kept it from them. But instead, Luke is focusing on the breaking of the bread that they noticed their Messiah. We know that these two disciples, one of them mentioned their name was Claudius, the other doesn't give their name. They weren't present at the Lord's Supper there in the upper room. We do know that Jesus had many disciples, more than just the 12. So the emphasis on the breaking of the bread is obviously important to Luke because of its great detail that he goes into it. Later in verse 34, he says, the Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. But he gives no more detail about what Simon encountered. Instead, Luke focuses on this breaking of the bread to these disciples at Emmaus. So what is so important of this? Could it be because they ate with him many times before? They noticed him breaking of the bread? They had seen this before? Perhaps. I mean, they were followers of Jesus. Surely they broke bread with him before. His followers had seen him take a little boy's lunch of 2 fish and 5 loaves, bless the food, break it, and distribute it among the thousands of people. They saw that. Perhaps it was in his action that they recognized him. His action of providing for them. His action of loving them. Caring for them. Let me ask you a question. Do others recognize us when we follow the Lord's command in action? Do they notice that? By helping others, by caring for one another? Are you recognized by your loving action? Or your actions and doubts keeping you from being recognized as a follower of Jesus Christ? We have to get right with God. We have to make sure that we are showing that love to others, that they know that this is a sign of Jesus Christ's love. And it flows through us so that we can give it to someone else. It's through that that they recognize us. In just a little bit, we're going to have a time of, we're going to distribute the elements of the bread and the cups. And if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, then you're welcome to join us in this. I'm going to lead us in a prayer to get right with God before we do this. This is a very special time that I look forward to. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you now with our sin and with our doubts, and we lay it at your feet, Lord. We ask you to open our eyes to sin in our lives. We come to you asking forgiveness of those sins. Forgive us, Lord, where we have let Satan direct our decisions. For when we have acted without seeking your direction, when we are in doubt, Father, forgive us. Help our faith, Lord. Help us to take your word as the authority over all other news or gossip or whatever we hear, whatever we read, whatever situation we're in. Father, we know that no problem is too great for you. And so help us to focus on you and not the problem, Lord. Turn our worries into assurance for you. Father, we thank you for the ultimate sacrifice of your only Son, Jesus Christ. Father, thank you for that love. We pray this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. I'd like to ask the deacons if they would come forward at this time. So first we will pass out the bread, take it, and then we'll pass out the cups and then take it.
In this bread of life, and we drink
On the night of his betrayal, as the 12 were gathered there in the upper room, Jesus took the bread. He blessed it, and he broke it and gave it to each of them. He said, "This is my body, which is given to you and is about to be broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Need all four? Maybe. Okay. All right.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us, and we remember the promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of peace around the table of the King. The body of our Savior Jesus Christ torn for you.
In the same manner, Jesus took the cup and said, "This is my blood poured out for all of you for the new covenant." This replaces the old covenant. No more sacrifices will ever have to be made. Jesus says, "I am the sacrifice. Do this in remembrance of me." Well, that concludes today's worship service, and I pray that we all go out and put our love of Christ into action in the community, that people, when they see you coming, they know that you belong to Jesus Christ, and that would be, it'd be something that is addicting, they can't help but notice, and they can't help but share that with somebody else. So I pray that y'all have a blessed week. And John, would you mind closing the prayer? Thank you, sir.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for this time we can get in your house, Lord, just to worship you, just to bring to your word, just your message. Father, our lives, Lord. Just the sacrifice that was